Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the second book of Kings. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. keep silent. Elijah said to him, Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho. But he said, as the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you. So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you? And he answered, yes, I know. Be silent. Then Elijah said to him, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan. But he said, as the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you. So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other, until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you. Elisha said, please let me inherit a double share of your spirit. He responded, you have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not. As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen. But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. The word of the Lord.
Lord. A reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. If our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Whenever I hear these mountaintop stories, it takes me back to when I lived in the mountains, in northern New Mexico, to be exact, an area with beautiful and stunning mountain ranges and singular peaks. When I lived in northern New Mexico, I had a friend there, really an adoptive father, who was a potter. He was a member of the Santa Clara people, and they followed a very ancient form of creating pottery, much older than the potter's wheel, where clay would be shaped, and then as it dried into a kind of leathery texture, a cut piece of obsidian would be used to scrape and scrape and scrape and scrape the walls of the pots until they became so thin you were amazed that the piece could even stand, so thin that it seemed the light could shine right through the clay. Northern New Mexico itself is what is often called a thin place. From our Celtic roots, thin places are those places where it seems the veil between the way we usually see things and the way things really are, that is, full of light and radiance, is so thin that we can experience both at the same time. Today we hear a story about Mount Tabor and the experience that these three disciples have of Jesus on this thin place, in this thin place. And when I lived in northern New Mexico, there were many tops of mountains that were likewise thin places. And probably you have your own catalog of places like that yourselves. and experiences that go along with them. But if we think about it, if all creation is holy, it's actually true that every place is a thin place. And the question isn't really whether we can get to a certain thin place, although that can be helpful. But the question really is, how thin are we? Not in catalog terms, but in spiritual terms. How able are we to see across two sides of the veil? And when we have these thin experiences, these experiences like we hear about today, this transfiguration experience, we tend over time sometimes to misconstrue them and misunderstand them because they're not the way we typically operate. In other words, they're not the way we experience the world when we're asleep. For example, the transfiguration that we hear about today. We might think that what we read about in this story and this amazing image we see described has to do with how different Jesus is from us. How different the divine is from the human. That there is this great chasm between radiance and light and bleach better than bleach, and how we live and think and act and have our being. But if we thought that, we'd actually be stepping away from what our church tradition has taught for 2,000 years. We'd be stepping away from the core reality that what the Transfiguration shows us, according to the fathers and mothers of the early church, is not the difference between Jesus and us, not the divinity, but the humanity. What we see in the picture of the Transfiguration is a mirror of our own humanity. The Transfiguration, we could say, is a human experience. We hear about Moses going through this experience back in the Hebrew Scriptures. And it's a Christian experience. Many saints through time, even into modern times, have had this experience. The Transfiguration, in fact, I would say, is our mission statement in a picture as Christians. Here's what C.S. Lewis says about this. He writes, "The command, be perfect, is not idealistic gas, nor is it a command to do the impossible. God said in the Bible that we were gods, and he is going to make good his words. He will make the feeblest and filthiest of us into a god or goddess, dazzling, radiant, immortal creatures, pulsating all through with such energy and joy and wisdom and love as we cannot now imagine. A bright, stainless mirror, which reflects back to him perfectly, though of course on a smaller scale, his own boundless power and delight and goodness. The process will be long and in parts very painful, but that is what we are in for. Nothing less. He meant what he said." C.S. Lewis isn't talking about any kind of New Age mumbo jumbo. He's quoting not only the Hebrew Scriptures, but centuries of church tradition. From Irenaeus of Lyon in the late 100s, through Augustine of Canterbury, Thomas Aquinas, and many others, we come upon this phrase in their writing: God became human, that humans might become God. Isn't it strange that if this is a core teaching of our church over 2,000 years, that it sounds, well, kind of strange? And I think there's two reasons it sounds strange to us today. The first is the pandemic. Now, I'm not talking about COVID-19. I'm talking about a different pandemic, a pandemic called Jansenism. It was a heresy from the 16th century that focused so heavily on human sin and guilt and the depravity of the human being that there was no room in it for the divine truth that we are made in the image and likeness of God. There was no room in it for the answer to St. Paul's question to us, "Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit?" And so the church condemned it. It was condemned, but never eradicated. It's been a co-infection that has been with us since the time of the Black Death. And so we tend to think too small of ways about ourselves. We tend to think of ourselves as what is broken rather than what is right. And of course, what we think about is what we focus on, and what we focus on is where we end up. And there's another reason, too, that this truth gets misunderstood. And that's because there's a catch to it. You see, we all know people, don't we, who think they're God. And we all know what we think about people who think they're God. We can't use those words in church. But that's not what we're talking about here. The part of us that becomes divine isn't the part of us that wants to become divine. This isn't about expanding our egos or puffing up our personalities like some Roman emperor. It's about surrendering them. It's about becoming so empty that there's room for the light and radiance of God to shine through us. It's about what we hear in the text today. It's about listening to Him as opposed to what's going on in here. It's about scraping away at the clay of our ego so that it becomes so thin that it can barely stand and the light of God can shine through it. So how do we do this? If this is our job description as Christians, how do we do our jobs? Well, I think the first thing to realize is that the good news is that the mountaintop isn't only on the mountaintop. If every place is a thin place, then it's every moment of our lives, every place we are, where we can be about this work. And of course, we don't do this work, do we? Our work is backing off so that the Holy Spirit can do the work in us. But even backing off is enough work most of the time. I do think the key seems to be in listening. Spending quiet time to hear how God's Spirit is moving in us. So when we sit in traffic, maybe not complaining that we're not getting what we want by arriving where we want at the moment we want to, but taking space and saying a sacred word. Or simply accepting that reality for what it is, something not in our control, but something that we're a part of. When we do this, we're on the mountaintop. Or when we're listening to one another or working with one another or doing collaborative work as we will do after this liturgy in our annual meeting, and we hear someone speaking, instead of already formulating what I'm going to say next as they're talking, perhaps I listen and I become quiet and I don't worry about what I'm going to say, and I try to hear how God is talking to me through that other person. When I do that, I'm on the mountaintop. And when we do this work, electing vestry members, approving our budget, figuring out in these concrete ways how God's great dream for reality is going to happen here and now through us, when we do work that makes us enter into something larger than our small selves, then too, we're on the mountaintop. And as we celebrate Valentine's Day today, creating time and maybe our own rituals like flowers or a dinner out to honor the power of love in our lives and to honor the love that we have for our beloved ones through whom God shines like radiant light to us. Maybe we make space too to honor that deep, nearly romantic desire we have for God's love directly, that hunger, that want, that need for divine love in our life. When we open space for that desire, we're on the mountaintop. It all depends on whether in these situations we follow what the gospel advises. Listen to Him. Each of us has our own ways of listening, I think, and we cultivate those through our lives. I'll share a few of mine with you and a few ways where I don't listen too. I find that when I'm trying hard to get what I want, and I'm in urgency, and I feel I'm in competition with other people, I'm not listening. And when my ego self puts my want list in the driver's seat, and there isn't room for God's voice and God's plan, and maybe not even room for the next right thing to do because what I want might be different than that, I'm not listening. And when it seems life is happening to me instead of with me or for me, I'm not listening. But when I'm trying to find how my great passion aligns with the world's deep need, I'm listening. When I'm trying to find how the Holy Spirit is speaking through events that I can't control, but that desire some response from me that makes the gospel maybe a little more real in my corner of the world, I'm listening. When I experience others and the world as an invitation rather than a threat, I'm listening. And when I can see my religious practice and my faith life not as a self-improvement program about me, but as a self-involvement program about the world, I'm listening. Being on the mountaintop is a matter of listening. Through listening, we are made bit by bit, scrape by scrape, into a clear channel of God's love and light and life. That we, just like Christ, have that divine light shot through and shining through us. And this is practical, day by day stuff. It's the stuff of how we watch our minds and tame our tongue. It's the stuff of how we move forward together, annual meeting after annual meeting, vestry meeting after vestry meeting, committee gathering after coffee hour as church. It's the stuff of how we let love rule our hearts and our choices. It's as real and down and dirty as scraping clay with an obsidian blade. Pass by pass by pass. And our tradition teaches us that we can be assured of this, that each of us, whatever the clay of our lives look like, however cracked or broken we may be in certain places, each of us is a vessel through which that light desires to shine. Each of us, whether or not we have a Valentine on this side of the veil, is so deeply and passionately loved by God that God wants nothing more than to shine through each of us and express that divine love in a way particular to what we bring to the table. All we have to do to have transfiguration in our lives and the life of the world every single day is listen. Listen and scrape, scrape, scrape. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of his Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven,
By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. We pray especially for Harry, Baker, Mark, Robin, Jackie and family, Bill, Patty, Ansley and family, Nancy, Ray, Colin, Lynn, Tori and family, Astrid, Jeff, Sid, Clark, Suzanne, John, Nancy, Ken and Maureen, Michelle, Jonathan, Pat, Jerry, Pam, Dean, John, Wilma, Doug, William, Bob, Jennifer, Jesse, Walt, and Derek. We pray especially also for the clergy and staff of our parish, for our pastoral care ministers, our parish day school, our companion diocese in the Dominican Republic, and the members of our armed forces deployed abroad, especially Rich, Mike, and Jake. We also pray for our rector search. Almighty God, giver of every good gift, look graciously on your church and so guide the minds of those who shall choose a rector for this parish, that we may receive a faithful pastor who will care for your people and equip us for our ministries through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And for our annual meeting. Almighty and ever-living God, source of all wisdom and understanding, Be present with those who take counsel for the renewal and mission of your church. Teach us in all things to seek first your honor and glory. Guide us to perceive what is right, and grant us both the courage to pursue it and the grace to accomplish it. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we pray for all those who are suffering the effects of the pandemic and other natural disasters, and healthcare workers, first responders, and all others whose work puts them in danger. We give thanks for their many sacrifices for the common good. Protect them from injury and illness, renew their wisdom, compassion, and strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom, especially Sydney and Rick. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And welcome to St. John's. If you're here in the church or whether you're online with us, it is good to be together as the body of Christ. We just have a few brief announcements this last Sunday after Epiphany. Although we're not passing the plate for health reasons, we do depend upon your tithes and offerings. And so if you're here in the church, and you have an offering to give, there are plates in the back of the church. And also, if you would like to give online, we have several options to do that, and it is very handy indeed. We appreciate very much your stewardship, and everything that the church does is made possible by your stewardship. Thank you so much. The annual meeting is here today. After this service, we'll start at 11:30. If you've not already voted, please go vote in the parish office just right after this service. Looking ahead to Wednesday, this coming Wednesday we'll begin Lent, Ash Wednesday, and we're going to have three services, 7 a.m., 12:15 p.m., and 7 o'clock p.m. The 7 o'clock service will be
broadcast online and will feature a choral, the choir, and Mr. Morley's music. There is a special thing we're doing this year because of the pandemic, and that is packaging of ashes to go. So in the back of the church, on a table there at the narthex, right in front of the baptismal font, is a basket full of prepackaged and blessed ashes, along with some words to go with it. So if you are going to watch the service at home online, then please take one with you. There's plenty to go around, and you may apply the ashes at the right time during the service, or if you can't make it to a service and you wish to impose the ashes or sprinkle the ashes upon yourself, then it will be good for that as well. And it's also good to know that every child of the school has or will receive that package as well. So we will be united on that day, that Ash Wednesday. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Saint John and all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Amen. May Christ, the Son of God, be manifest in you, that your lives may be a light to the world. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
yesterday too. It was 4.5 hours.
Because before it was like that.
I know. Still, because they haven't solved it.
How are you doing?
You realize it's 12:15. I know. The schedule's at 12.
Oh, yeah. Well, I would have been here at 12 anyway, so. Yeah, I did hear that. I thought it was 10, but that's okay.
Well, my wife told me 12, and then they decided to go.
Yeah, I'll be here on Wednesday.
That's Sharon.
Well, it helps us.